We will have our first plenary session. We should get started because we're a little bit beyond schedule. So I would like to introduce at my right, she will be the first one to talk, Professor Beatriz Bossi, whose title is Back to the Cock on Gratitude and Care. Professor Beatriz Bossi is associate professor from 2007 at the Faculty of Philosophy at the Complutense University of Madrid. She is author of Virtud y Conocimiento en Platón y Aristóteles, La Fuerza de un Malentendido, de 2000, Saber Gozar, Estudios sobre el Placer en Platón, 2008, and co-editor of Plato's Sophist Revisited, 2013. She has published more than 50 papers all over the world, and she's also a member of the editorial board of the IPS. So, Professor Beatriz Bossi.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Gabriele, for organizing this conference, and I'm very happy to be here. I did not expect to start this conference because I thought my subject was about the end, but here I am. So I have changed a bit the version you have, but not too much. So I think you can follow the most important things from what you have on the net. So I'll start. Crito, we owe a cock to Asklepios. You all pay our debt and do not be careless. Socrates' last words have been taken to mean that he owes a cock to Asklepios because he is thanking him for healing him of the sickness of life by the cure of death. This allegorical mystical interpretation, attested in antiquity in a scholium by Damasius, was popular in the Italian Renaissance, Pico della Mirandola, Ficino, Riccieri, and in the Romantic period, Hahn, Lamartine, Nietzsche, and it is to be found in most modern scholarly treatments of the question. It finds support on the disdain of the body, which is something to flee from, because as long as our soul is fussed with such an evil, we shall not attain truth. Excessive passion should be repressed. Scholars who agree on this allegorical Nietzschean reading include Barnett, Del Rey, Pluck, Tredenick, Gill, Daughter, Rowe, Grube, and Nehemas. Apart from being paradoxical, for Asklepios saves from death, not from life, in my view, the Nietzschean interpretation could be objected that A, Socrates never says that life is a disease, or that death is its cure in the dialogue. B, the body may be an obstacle to knowledge if treated in excess, but it is equally essential to start the process of knowledge for human beings. C, Socrates does not have a personal debt. He uses the verb in the first person plural. We owe a cock to Asklepios. On the other hand, those who interpret the last words as referring to an actual debt include Villamovitz, Hackforth, and Gallup, while Gautier took them to mean to have no particular meaning, for he assumed that they were made a deranged babbling as the result of too much poison. All right. In a very comprehensive paper following both Villamovitz's literary view that Socrates must express gratitude not for his own death but for someone else's rescue on the one hand, and also Clark's suggestion that the one saved must be Plato on the other hand, most argues that Socrates had a sudden clairvoyant vision and announced that Plato had been healed and that a thank offering must be made to Asklepios on behalf of all of them. The author also suggests that Socrates seems almost, I quote, Socrates seems almost to be designating Plato as his legitimate successor as the custodian of his arguments. And that, I quote, if this or something like it was indeed Plato's interpretation of Socrates' last words, then we cannot help but feel admiration for his tact and literary artistry. In my view, there is no evidence in the dialogue for such a vision of Plato's healing or for the idea that Plato was seriously ill, and in danger of dying. Such an assumed announcement remains equally cryptic to friends and readers. On the other hand, there are more important reasons to reject this interpretation, for it is difficult to imagine that Plato had conceived such a trick to be alluded in Socrates' final words, as if the most important message to mankind from his master at such a crucial point were to announce that he, Plato, had suddenly recovered health and that he was Socrates' heir. In the first place, because Plato never thought that philosophy is a kind of possession to inherit, but an activity one must strive for. Secondly, if that were Plato's intention, rather than denoting tact and artistry, it would denote arrogance and roughness, two attitudes that would conflict with the pedagogical project of the dialogue as a whole. More recently, Crookes, following Mr. Michelin's view that the last words constitute a deliberate anti-Pythagorean heresy because the Pythagoreans forbid the sacrifice of cocks, according to Iamblichus and Diogenes Laertius, claims that Socrates reacts against Simmias and Cibes' misology, disease, for which Socrates is the cure. I agree about the need of a cure and about Socrates encouraging the group to keep on exercising the life of inquiry as a course of therapy. The author thinks that the reference to Asklepios at 118 is an acknowledgement of having met this need. He writes, I quote, "The pathos of mythology has been superseded." However, one could object that in the mythology passage, Socrates claims that they are not yet sound, but must strive to attain soundness. His friends, for the sake of their whole life still to come, and he himself, for the sake of death itself. This means that the pathos of mythology has not been superseded, and that Socrates cannot claim victory for this therapy yet. His gratitude to Asklepios could not be attributed to such a big victory. With regard to the Pythagorean heresy, Cumont has observed that the text does not say that Socrates had promised a cock to be sacrificed, but just that they owe a cock to the god. These animals were nourished in Asklepios' temples for the cures, but perhaps also just to wake up the patients from their incubation therapy. If this were so, the text would not turn out to be anti-Pythagorean after all. On the other hand, one may have the impression that the real Pythagorean who takes care of the soul is Socrates, in spite of his interlocutor's assumed philo-like connection. 2, collecting clues. In this paper, I would like to attempt to offer an alternative contribution to the understanding of Socrates' famous last words. In the first place, we should attempt to understand Socrates' final words in the light of the Phaedo as a whole. The dialogue is about how to take care of the soul in order to lead a valuable life and be ready to face death in the hope of immortality. The readiness is all, Hamlet Dixit. I find it consistent with Plato's main purpose to assume that Socrates' final words refer to something essentially connected to psychic health in order to lead a good life, which naturally also implies physical care of the body. I do not expect to offer a completely new interpretation, as mine owes a lot to the work of many scholars, but to offer some light on this old riddle, which I'm afraid we can never be sure to have deciphered perfectly well. Plato loves hiding, nature and Plato. It is clear that the first clause, Crito, we owe a cock to Asklepios, refers neither to Socrates himself exclusively, nor to a future favor he expects to get. When Socrates suddenly uncovers his head as if he felt an urge and says that they have a debt, it is reasonable to think that he feels gratitude for something that has already been given, and that it has been given not only to him, but also to his friends, for all of them are in debt. And as they have a debt, Socrates gives an order to Crito that involves all the group, apodote. The verb basically means give up or give back, restore, return. He commands them to make the offering to Asklepios as a return for something they have been given. What could be the healthy gift conceded to all of them by the god of medicine? Needless to say, it cannot be physical health, for that is not a common condition, to Socrates, who is dying, and to his friends, who are safe and sound. But physical health is not the only purpose of the god of medicine either. Plato refers to Asklepios in the Republic, and there he says that this god taught medicine to those whose bodies are healthy in their natures and habits, but have some specific disease, and then order them to live their usual life, quote, so as not to harm their city's affairs. But the god did not assume that he should treat someone who should not live a normal life, someone who was sick by nature or due to a licentious lifestyle. It would not be profitable either to himself or to anyone else. Socrates comments that this Asklepios was quite a statement. However, he complains that Pindar and the tragedians do not agree with this description that attributes the god's sovereign criteria to act, but on the contrary, they say that Asklepios was bribed with gold to heal a rich man. Socrates declares that this cannot be the case if he was the son of Apollo. At the end of the passage, Socrates also claims that doctors treat the bodies along with their souls, and that it is not possible for the soul to treat anything well if it is or has been bad in itself. So the doctor has to have his soul in order to treat somebody else. In the eyes of Socrates, the god of medicine decides who deserves treatment and who does not, according to the nature and moral habits of the patients, because he cares for the common good of the city as a whole, and this god cannot be bribed. If this is so, his decisions concern more important issues than just technical treatments to recover the physical health at all costs. There is a passage in the Phaedo which in a sense seems to adumbrate the passage of the Republic. Socrates claims that in some circumstances and for some people, it is better to die than to live. It seems strange or difficult for them to understand that they cannot commit suicide. All the same, he says, there is probably a certain reasonableness about this. He says, I quote, "The gods are the ones who take care of us, and we, human beings, are one of their possessions." And he adds that one should not kill oneself until a god sends some necessity upon him, such as has now come upon us. Prin ananken tina theos epimpempe, hosper kai tenin humin parousan. In the passage of the Republic, we happen to learn that the god who decides who is to be cured and who is to die, all things considered, is Asklepios. However, his decisions are presented not as if they were arbitrary, but quite reasonable, for they are to take into account the best of the individuals and the common good as well. Here we are told that our lives belong to the gods, who are supposed to be wise and take care of us. Both passages combined seem to suggest that it would be Asklepios, the god who has sent Socrates and his friends the necessity that has forced Socrates to accept his death. However, Socrates does not meet the requirements that incline Asklepios to put a man to death. He is not ill either in his body or in his soul, and he is persuaded that his life could be valuable for the city. In this sense, the necessity remains unexplained. It is not explained. Socrates builds the argument against suicide not only to persuade Thebes, but also because, I suggest, he himself cannot completely understand why it is necessary for him to die right now. In the passage, he seems to be submitting his reason to his piety. More importantly, the fact that Socrates needs to justify the necessity of his death by the god's will It is clear indication that he is neither happy about his death nor grateful to the god for it, even when he might be ready to accept it as necessary given the circumstances. Let me insist, he needs to justify his death as something necessary that the gods allow for reasons he cannot grasp at this stage. He trusts the wise god who takes care of human beings. If this is so, it does not seem plausible to assume that Socrates felt that they had a debt to Asklepios for sending him the necessary circumstance. On the other hand, the fact that Socrates thinks that Asklepios cannot be bribed indicates that Socrates cannot be asking Crito to make an offering in exchange for a benefit he would attain in the near future. Socrates finds he should say his prayer to the gods in order that, quote, in order that his removal from this to that other place may be attended with good fortune. Once he has finished his prayer, it does not seem likely that he would utter a second religious demand for his own good destiny. What kind of health did Asklepios deal with? He is said to be able to bring others back to life from the brink of death and beyond. He should have been an expert at initiating the adept into the mysteries of the beyond and eternal health of the soul. Ritual purification would be followed by offerings of sacrifices to the god, followed by the offerings and sacrifices to the god according to means. And the supplicant would then spend the night in the holiest part of the sanctuary for therapy, included interpretation of dreams and visions by the priests. Now, if we take into account the wide range of combined powers ascribed to the god of medicine and the need for doctors to keep their own souls in a good condition in order to be able to heal others with their souls, quote, with their souls, along with the fact that ancient therapy included a combination of physical and psychological treatments, we should conceive health as a whole. Moreover, Socrates seems to believe that bodily health depends on psychic health, as it is clear shown in the Charmides, where a holistic approach to health is defended. In a famous passage that refers to Salmoxis, Socrates claims, quote, because, he said, the soul is the source both of bodily health and bodily disease for the whole man, and these flow from the soul in the same way that the eyes are affected by the head. So it is necessary first and foremost to cure the soul, if the parts of the head and the rest of the body are to be healthy. And the soul, he said, my dear friend, is cured by means of certain charms, and these charms consist of noble arguments. It is a result of such arguments that moderation arises in the soul. And when the soul acquires and possesses temperance, well, moderation sophrosyne, it is easy to provide health both for the head and the rest of the body. End of the quote. Socrates attempts to play the doctor and relieve Charmides' headache by using enchantments. In the Phaedo, these enchantments are not equated with noble arguments as in the Charmides, but are more closely linked to certain emotional powers of persuasion. Socrates encourages his friends to sing charms to the child inside them every day until they charm away his fear. When Zeus asks Socrates where they would find a good singer of charms, since he's about to die, Socrates replies, quote, Hellas, Thebes is a large country in which there are many good men, and there are many foreign peoples also. You ought to search through all of them in quest of such a charmer, sparing neither money nor toil, for there is no greater need for which you could spend your money. And you must seek among yourselves too, for perhaps you would hardly find others better able to do this than you. End of the quote. Socrates urges them to operate as charmers, to help one another attain serenity and confidence as for himself, as he himself attempts to do along the dialogue. The comparison between these two passages takes us to the view that we should not put too much pressure on the separation of physic and psychic health. For the god seems to be able to deal with both issues, and Socrates regards both aspects intimately related. Though the description of the therapy of enchantment seems to be different when applied to the headache and to fear. Socrates resembles Asklepios in two respects. He does not accept payment either, and he also chooses who is to be accepted for a second chance at being cross-examined by him and who is to be rejected, according to the Theaetetus. So let us conclude this section by remarking some relevant partial results. One, Socrates is convinced that the god, presumably Asklepios or his father Apollo, has sent him a necessary circumstance that took him to the verge of death, and he is persuaded that the god, being good and wise, knows why it has to be so. Two, the dramatic action presents Socrates in a calm mood, playing a kind of peculiar medical charmer who encourages them to lead a risky, courageous, philosophical life and to charm themselves in order to attain serenity to face death. Three, Socrates cannot possibly demand Crito to offer a cock to Asklepios to obtain a future benefit from him, for he does not have a commercial view of religion, and Asklepios cannot be bribed. On the contrary, as they are in debt, Socrates wants them to pay it off, presumably in a gesture of gratitude for a healthy gift that all of them could have attained somehow. Four, his final command, "Do not be careless," cannot possibly refer back to the cock, but in my view, is expression of his fear that they could spoil Asklepios' gift, that is to say, their respective lifespan, if they did not care for the health of their souls. Now, if this analysis is right, I think we should distinguish carefully between Socrates' condition of good hope and his final gratitude and fear. With regard to himself, Socrates hopes his soul is about to be liberated from the body and all its infirmities and be restored to her primal purity and health, which would enable him to learn in the blessing company of the gods. On the other hand, with regard to his friends, I dare say that at the end of the day, he feels satisfied that he could do a good job by showing them, in words and exercise, how to argue, how to set limits to the excessive demands of the body, and how to charm themselves in order to remain serene in the face of death. In a word, he has encouraged them to take the risk to strive for a philosophical life. Therefore, Socrates is grateful to Asklepios because he was given the time and chance to do his job correctly, with a helpful contribution of Father Apollo, who kept the sacred ship sailing on the sea. However, the final verdict belongs to the gods. Though he thinks that he has left nothing undone in his eagerness to become one of those who have practiced philosophy in the correct way, as to whether his energy has been spent correctly and they have made any progress, they will know the plain truth, God willing, when they get to that other place. Why does Socrates understand that they all have a debt? I think we can imagine he wants all of them to feel engaged in his gratitude and last humble offering, because all of them have enjoyed the care and teaching Socrates devoted to them on the last days in prison. Socrates himself seems to have enjoyed their affectionate company, complaints, fears, and doubts included. And having them all gather in a final sacred offering might also contribute to their remaining faithful to his heritage. Let me attempt to offer evidence of this interpretation. 3. Socrates' last will, a key passage. Socrates gives his final piece of advice to the group, me amelesete. In the absolute sense is frequent in Attic. By using a negative clause, do not be careless. If the clause me amelesete refer to the cock, it would be either trivial or redundant or both. When Socrates is about to die, Plato cannot be trivial. The death must be significant. Socrates is a pious man. The cock actually had to be offered, and the apodote is enough to make him himself sure of that, pace the Pythagorean bit. If that were really so. On the other hand, Plato seems to be less interested in sex rights than in Philolaus philosophy. When Socrates has neither more time nor much energy left, it would be strange to insist on the cock issue. But it would be appropriate to remind them all the purpose they should have in life. In my view, Chi is not explicative, but conductive. For it adds Socrates' most important message in a nutshell. I think it's worthwhile to quote Madison at this point. She says, quote, "It's difficult to maintain that a writer and thinker of Plato's caliber would compose the dying words of his mentor in such an artless manner. Pay the debt, and don't forget to pay the debt." Moreover, Socrates cannot be worried about Critias being negligent about the cock for three reasons. A, because a cock is a poor offering. B, because Crito is wealthy. And C, most importantly, because Crito is eager to fulfill Socrates' will in every respect. This is confirmed by Crito himself as he immediately assures Socrates that his request will be fulfilled. I believe that the first part of Socrates' final clause prescribes gratitude, and the second one prescribes care. While the first part looks at the past, the second one faces the future. And the negative adverb, I suggest, denotes Socrates' fears not about the cock, but about something much more important, the care of their souls. The Socrates is really worried about this issue is evident when he says, I quote, "If the soul is immortal, it requires our care, not only for the time we call our life, but for the sake of all time. And from that perspective, one is in terrible danger if one does not give it that care." Three passages above, we have a precious passage in which Socrates gives his friends a key message. In my view, this passage turns out to be essential to understand Socrates' last words. I quote, "Well, Socrates, do you wish to leave any directions with us about your children or anything else? Anything we can do to serve you?" Crito asks. Socrates replies, "What I always say, Crito, nothing very new. If you care for your own selves, whatever you do will be pleasing me and to mine. Sorry, will be pleasing to me and to mine. And to your and to you yourselves too. Even if you do not agree with me now. But if you neglect your own selves, if you neglect your own selves and are unwilling to live following the tracks, as it were, of what we have said now and on previous occasions, you will achieve nothing, even after having vehemently agreed with me in the present circumstances many times over." Crito wants to know which is Socrates' last will. The answer contains key elements that can help us decipher the enigmatic riddle. I would dare say that Plato could leave the riddle unsolved because he had already given the clues to solve it in a general way through the whole dialogue and in particular in this passage. People who are about to die often give the same obsessive messages to their relatives about what they should do once they have passed away. Socrates' final sudden urge refers to a debt he wants to pay off, for he feels gratitude for a healthy achievement they were allowed to manage. But Socrates is aware of the fact that that attainment could be put at risk if they did not persevere. Let us analyze the clues we can collect from the passage just quoted. First, one, it is significant that Socrates' last will remains the same. We read in the Gorgias a famous passage where Socrates says that he is in love with Alcibiades and with philosophy, but he prefers philosophy. Why? Because she always says the same. What we should know is not much, and it is always the same. This sameness manifests Socrates' steadiness. He is not going to ask them to do anything new, but what he always repeats, haper ai lego, efe o krito, uden kai noteron. For he has all his desires and expectations focused on just one objective. This sameness also supports the view that the last words cannot introduce a strange novelty about out of the blue, but had to be understood in the light of the dialogue as a whole. Two, the content of Socrates' last will is focused on his friends. It is a generous will. Socrates needs nothing for himself, but he would be pleased if his friends took care of themselves. He does not say that they should take care of their souls exclusively, but of themselves to cur, himon auton epimelumenoi, which allows us to interpret that he expects them to take care of themselves as a unity. Obviously, taking care of themselves implies a care of their most important part. And again, if they took care of their souls, they would also take care of their bodies properly, because we have learned from the comedies, the correct treatment of the soul engenders sophrosyne, which in turn secures health to the body. Three, we also learn that this care provokes joy. The language denotes that it would please Socrates in the sense that he would be given a kind of special gift or grace, charis. This does not necessarily mean that Socrates imagines the joy he would experience if he could contemplate his friends on their right tracks in his afterlife. But rather, it could be taken as something they could do for themselves in his memory. I understand this answer is emerging from Socrates' interest and care for them. In addition, we are told that this care would provoke joy also to Socrates' close relatives, to mine. And last but not least, the most interesting point is perhaps that this peculiar care he has always been talking about would give joy to themselves. Analogously, in the Republic, Socrates uses the best kind of pleasure, the most real and steady one, to persuade his interlocutors to choose the highest life they can give themselves. These examples show us that Socrates not only values this joy or high pleasure, but has no objection to use it as part of his argument for a careful, examined life. Four, Socrates' tone here, though firm, is much less imperative than in the final words. He is not under the urge of the poison yet. However, in this message, in the intimacy of friendship just before the arrival of Socrates' family, he is firm and attempts to be persuasive because he is aware of the fact that they are in such a low mood that it would be difficult for them to accept that this care for themselves could make them feel happy now that their mentor is about to leave them alone. And that is why he adds that this is so, even if they do not agree with him now. Kai me nun homologesite. Socrates could either refer to their former agreements along the dialogue or to the promises they could make immediately after. In fact, as Rowe observes, Simmias and, I quote, Simmias and Sibs have gone on assenting to Socrates' proposal about the importance of caring for themselves many times. Indeed, as soon as Socrates stops talking, Crito hurries to promise they will do so. Five, The positive reason for a careful, examined life is joy. The other side of the coin, the negative effect of a careless life, is insignificance or mediocrity. If they were negligent about themselves, that's the word Monique Tissot uses in her translation, they would not do much with their lives. They would live like mortal slaves who lead an unpurified, mean life if they forget their souls and give up striving for the truth. They would be like those whose exchange, which comes in the Phaedo, this important passage a lot of people are going to talk about here. They would be like those who exchange smaller pleasures for greater pleasures of the same kind, and bigger fears for smaller fears without wisdom. They would be just apparently virtuous. Socrates has reasons for feeling afraid, because he's aware that there are many that carry the tears, but in truth, few that are the gods. The Laches echoes the same lesson. If they do not take care of themselves, they will turn out to be nobodies and will not become worthy of their names. Four, back to the final words. Let us precise a bit more which kind of healthy gift Asklepios could have conceded to them all. I agree with Madsen that the favor was presumably granted during the discussion they have had together, and that their healing has to do with their conversion to philosophy. But I do not agree with her that Socrates has perceived, by the time he drinks his poison, that his friends have been healed from the terrible danger of carelessness because they have overcome the threat of misology. This solution seems problematic because Socrates says that we are not yet in a sound condition and that we must soldier on, eager to be sound, for the sake of the rest of our lives. Nobody can be out of danger once and forever, not even Socrates. Could it be that Socrates is grateful for the progress of his friends on a moral basis rather than on an intellectual one? This solution seems even worse. Let us take practical Crito, for instance. He expected Socrates would accept to escape from jail, believed that Socrates could be identified with his corpse, suggested that he should enjoy some more time by drinking or having sexual intercourse before dying, and among others, could not help crying. It seems that Socrates' best friend needs more therapy than the one he could provide along the dialogue. Along this line, one may also wonder why, on the other hand, the wisest man in Athens was in love, among others, with Alcibiades, one of the worst men in town who horrified him, and, on the other hand, his best friend, Crito, could hardly understand his views and had to be taught and even was scolded by Socrates. What did Socrates find in these individuals to love them and take care for them? Neither of them seems good for philosophy, the former due to his political ambition and the latter due to simple mindedness and readiness to take the easiest shortcut. What do they have in common? Let me suggest two main features. Though they cannot follow Socrates for different reasons, both of them seem to be aware of their own limits and love him deeply. In Socrates' view, only the arrogant ignorant should be rejected. I would like to suggest that all of them owe a humble cup to Asklepios, not because they have already recovered their spiritual health, but because they have discovered and experienced somehow that the right track that leads to human healing from irrational fears of death and excessive bodily pleasure and nonsense is philosophy, the examined life of dialogue and search. And they have learned this not only through clever arguments on the immortality of the soul, but through their attesting Socrates' good hope, serenity, and care for them. We can assume then that Socrates has fulfilled his mission and dies as a philosopher. He can have the hope to have helped his friends to engage in it and have assuaged their anger and sorrow, while he encouraged them to enjoy discussion and never hid the difficulties that beset the arguments for personal immortality. But I cannot believe that he suddenly felt they owed a cock to Asklepios because all of them had already managed to do so. I would rather say that he might have felt that they had fulfilled a good task. He has managed to place them on the right track, as noble rhetors are said to do in the Phaedrus, where paragoi is likely to mean leading somebody somewhere else in order to reorient him. However, in our dialogue, they are left standing at the point of departure. And that is why he added a second clause, which cannot be either trivial or redundant. He encouraged them not to be careless. I take this to mean to provide themselves with their own care for themselves, body and soul. Socrates is in debt to Asklepios for conceding him the time and health, body and soul, to fulfill his mission. While they must give thanks to the God for healing, to the God of healing for his assistance in their conversion towards philosophy. But turning the direction of their heads toward a higher way of existence does not mean they have attained it. Socrates' healthy soul enables him to take care of himself and of his friends, like the gods take care of us. But now he must necessarily leave them, and his departure opens their ways to maturity and self-government. It's time to let them take care of themselves and of each other. The cock is a solar symbol, for it sings as it adumbrates a new day. Hopefully, Socrates will be led and under its auspices into a new, brighter dimension, while his friends, forgetful disciples, fearful children, and simple-minded men, will be standing on the right track after a restorative therapy towards excellence and proper intellectual health. Ready to start a new stage of courageous inquiry, moderation, and joy, if they do not turn out to be careless. Plato's concept of the soul is, in a sense, voluble. We are never free from the risk of becoming, like Penelope, weavers of souls that serve bodily patterns, while expecting philosophy to work in our release. In conclusion, though we cannot be absolutely sure about the ultimate meaning of Socrates' last words, which are likely to have broken a sacred silence, they must be both significant and coherent with the rest of the dialogue and with his life as a whole. In my view, to say it in Macfarren's words, Socrates, quote, lived the death that was within him. His last sudden urge seems to have bubbled up, pushed at least by certain emotional drives that can be collected throughout the dialogue. Pious gratitude for his joyful, risky, earthly life, along with the celebration of a modest philosophical triumph, Socrates has been able to move his friends towards courageous cross-examination and to charm them somehow for a while with his serene care for those whom he managed to love, warts and wrinkles. However, the enterprise is not over. Neither for his friends then, nor for us now. This morning in Brasilia, perhaps we still feel in need of Socrates' me amelesete. Be it as it may, for sure we are eager to start a fruitful week of courageous discussion in his honor. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Beatriz Bossi. Lopes will now introducing Professor Annie Larivée. She will talk us about Socrates as political Asklepios in the Phaedo. Professor Henri Larivée is Associate Professor of Philosophy at Carleton University in Ottawa, Canada. Following her doctoral dissertation entitled The Political Asklepios, a study on the care for the soul in Plato's dialogues at Paris University Paris I, Sorbonne, she has published numerous articles in French and English and is currently preparing a book on this topic. Her research focuses primarily on philosophy as a way of life, on the care of the soul or self as a practice of transformation in ancient and contemporary philosophy, on the protreptic genre, on the relation between psychology and philosophy, and on feminism and questions of gender. So, Professor Annie.
Thank you very much. So I think it's very interesting because there are quite a few commonalities between our two papers, but I will put the emphasis more on the political aspect of care. For those of you who, like me, are visual and want to follow my paper in the books, the book of papers, the English version is to be found at page 509. And if you prefer the French original version, which I think is slightly better, it's at page 528. Pour ceux qui veulent suivre le texte en français, donc vous pouvez le trouver à la page 528. Also, I want to mention that I will skip some passages because it was way too long. And these passages that I will skip are in light gray. As we learn in the Gorgias and the Laws, politics is the skill responsible for the care of the soul. There is something startling about this statement. The care of the soul, is that not the purview of philosophy? And when Socrates exhorts us to care for our souls, is that not an exhortation to practice philosophy? Is it possible to reconcile such a collective view of the care of the soul with Socrates' views in the Phaedo? Or are we confronted with an insurmountable contradiction? I will attempt to show that we are not by advancing a political reading of the Phaedo, or at least a politicizing one. I do not claim that the Phaedo is a political dialogue, an extravagant thesis. Rather, I simply suggest that we ought to read it in a political horizon in light of the philosopher's therapeutic mission. For Plato, this mission has a social dimension, which makes his work especially significant from the standpoint of sociology of knowledge. Furthermore, by paying particular attention to the performative aspect of Socrates' words, what he does with what he says, my approach will enable us to see that it is possible to reconcile the views on the care of the soul specific to this dialogue with those from the rest of the Platonic corpus taken in a Unitarian understanding. So first I will focus on the Phaedo's political background, which I think is important because we forget it too often. If there is one dialogue that depoliticizes our understanding of the care of the soul in the Platonic corpus, it is the Phaedo. Here, Socrates praises philosophy as the exercise of death, which evinces an extreme form of detachment of the soul from anything bodily. This spiritual exercise seems to be highly individualistic, solitary, an escape in solitude of the solitary, as Plotinus could put it, and therefore apolitical by definition. There is no use ignoring the fact that politics is hardly a concern in the Phaedo. Nevertheless, we should not ignore the way that the polis and the care that Socrates intended to provide it are tacitly present in the dialogue's background. Athens' anger and its tenuous relation with Socrates is the horizon of meaning that lends the dialogue its dramatic tension. Indeed, Socrates will soon die under the city's orders. Isolated from it for some time in prison, Socrates is about to be permanently removed from the city, loosened from it by force. For it is not Socrates who decided to separate himself from the city. Rather, it is the city is freeing itself from him, and the care of the soul has everything to do with this violent break. As described in the Apology, Socrates is condemned to drink the hemlock to put an end to his irritating mission to convince others to take care for their souls. Socrates' accusers claim that he corrupts the social body like a malady that especially targets the young shoots and leaves. His judges confirm this, and here we have the political conflict and the pedagogical problem without which there would be no Phaedo. Further, if Socrates had been content to stay in a corner and busy himself with detaching his soul from his body, or to engage in an escape in solitude of the solitary under an olive tree, there would be no Socrates either, not as we know him through Plato at least. Plato's Socrates is not an individual out of the world, embracing an ideal of solitary renunciation, an ideal which was flourishing in India at the time, and which later appeared in the West in the form of Christian asceticism. According to Louis Dumont, it is this type of asocial spirituality that conditioned the emergence of Western individualism, surprisingly. The individual in the world proper to modernity, an individual enamored of unfettered freedom, this is Dumont's expression, was intriguingly preceded by the individual out of the world of religious ascetic practices. But this is not the care for the self that Socrates promotes. Even in the Phaedo, Socrates does not fit the image of the solitary ascetic, solely preoccupied with his own salvation. If we wanted to make the comparison with Eastern wisdom, it is the spirit of the Bhagavad Gita that comes closest, with its total devotion to a divine mission, accompanied by a detachment from the fruits of the labor and the risks involved. Let us also note that Socrates did not spend his last days in isolation. Rather, he was the center of a small community of mutual care, simultaneously caring for himself and his friends. As usual, he is surrounded by other humans. They are devoted to him and need him for the welfare of their souls. And he too, seemingly, needs them. In this respect, it is interesting to note that the religion of the philosopher, which Socrates enthusiastically embraces in the Phaedo, suggests that dying completes his therapeutic responsibility towards others. Socrates is not a bodhisattva who, by compassion, will choose to re-enter the cycle of incarnation only in order to liberate every being from it. In his religion, the sage, once entirely liberated, never returns. He finally lives happily in the company of what he loves in the future altogether without a body. By the same token, this hope, which has all the allures of a fantasy, implicitly reveals that it is only in the afterlife that the Socratic sage gains the privilege to solely care for himself and to be selfish, so to speak. The collective and political dimension of the care of the soul that Socrates meets out his whole life is thus present in the Phaedo as an arrested therapeutic mission. It is a mission of care that was for a long time aimed at the city, practiced in the heart of the city, and brutally interrupted by the city. The constant allusions to the many, which Socrates could not persuade, and to his trial in the Phaedo, serve to remind us of the political nature of the exhortation to care and invite us to read the Phaedo together with its two dramatic antecedents, the Apology and the Crito, in a linear progression. When read together, these dialogues shed much light on two central elements of the therapeutic battle that Socrates waged at the socio-political level. First, over what priority to give the care of the soul, hence a battle over the hierarchy of values, which I think is a very ferocious social battle. And second, over the social recognition for a new expertise of care that has the soul as its central object. That was quite the challenge as well. These two battles unfold on public terrain, and the Phaedo plays indirectly a strategic role in these two battlefields. So I will begin with the second battle, namely the Phaedo as a proof of Socrates' therapeutic skills. A recurrent theme in the early dialogues is the search for an expert in the care of the soul. Who is this expert who is just as indispensable for the care of the soul as the physician and the trainer are for the care of the body? Where to find this individual who knows how to improve the psyche and to cultivate virtue within it? Socrates is not satisfied with posing this question just for his own profit or for the profit of those who share in his curiosity. He wants all Athenians to pose this question. Now, the Phaedo constitutes one element of Plato's response to this question relentlessly posed at the heart of the city. It is a piece of evidence. The expertise in the care of the soul, this new form of care, does exist, and it is possible to develop it. The fact that such a specialist has indeed existed, Socrates attests to this. In the Phaedo, this evidence takes several forms, first being that of testimony. The fact that taking good care of the soul is an art and is not just something anybody can do is a central theme in the Crito, but it is not discussed in the Phaedo. However, those who have benefited from Socrates' care express this idea emphatically in the context of the discussion. Several commentators have noted that Socrates' companions describe the deeds he performs for them as a kind of healing. I'm thinking particularly of the scene where Phaedo tells of how Socrates diagnosed the despondency into which Cebes' counter-argument had plunged them and knew how to cure the mythology that had threatened their souls. Cebes' attacks not only brought them to doubt the truth of Socrates' logoi concerning the immortality of the soul, but indeed had the harmful effect of shaking their faith in the helpful hygieis character of logoi in general, a much more grievous affliction. Now, Socrates, with his reliable art of diagnosis, not only perceived his comrades' state, but he also knew how to provide them with the appropriate remedy. As Phaedo explains, I quote, "I have certainly often admired Socrates at Crates, but never more than on this occasion." That he had a reply was perhaps not strange. What I wondered at most in him was the pleasant, kind, and admiring way he received the young man's arguments and how sharply he was aware of the effect the discussion had on us, and then how well he healed us. This description of Socrates' therapeutic act, one suited to affecting the reader just as much as the characters in the dialogue, is particularly revealing to the extent that Phaedo emphasizes that dialectical skills is not the only quality required for taking good care of the soul. A form of benevolence is necessary, and above all, a sort of psychological perceptiveness and diagnostic art are equally required. And this echoes Socrates' remarks on psychagogia in the Phaedrus. Although they are not visible, Socrates seems to see his friend's soul. He sees the state of the soul and knows how to guide it safely at the critical moment, the crisis. In fact, Socrates implicitly presents himself as an expert in these two domains when he explains to his companions that when it comes to the affairs of logoi and men alike, it is the lack of expertise, atechnia, and an imprudent trust that are the cause of disappointment and discouragement. This meta-argumentative passage not only helps to establish Socrates' therapeutic credentials, but also establishes the credibility of the care of the soul, a developing art lacking in public recognition, as evidenced by the dire situation in which Socrates finds himself. Now, I decided to skip the next section because I think Professor Bossi just covered this topic in a very satisfactory manner, and I think we basically agree on the interpretation of the last words. I use different sources. I use the very insightful and creative essay by Georges Mézil on the connection between the Crito and the Phaedo, and also the text by Santilli on the therapeutic meaning of the last words, but we fundamentally agree on this, on the meaning of the last words. So I will skip this section. I just mentioned that I think that it was a way for Plato to offer something like a myth of the origin for this new practice, this new therapeutic practice that targets the soul. So, the apology in the Phaedo can be read then as an attempt to give the physician of the soul something like a foundation story or a foundation myth. So I skip to my section, A Community of Mutual Care. Ran as a foundation myth, the Phaedo is not the story of an end, namely Socrates, but rather of a beginning. Although he is presented as an especially gifted practitioner of the care of the soul throughout the Phaedo, Socrates never pretends to be the sole possessor of this skill. In fact, he insists that his followers, who consider Socrates to be unique and irreplaceable, must begin searching for guides who are also able to provide such therapeutic incantations after his departure within Greece or even beyond. Socrates also suggests the possibility that they could play a similar role for one another. These remarks seem to imply that the skill in the care of the soul that Plato sought to promote with his dialogues is a sort of skill being developed within a community of research, not unlike the Hippocratic school for the care of the body. As described in the Phaedo, this therapeutic expertise is first to be practiced within a micro society of persons who develop and experiment in this therapeutic art together and who provide care for one another. Socrates takes this responsibility of mutual care very seriously. We can see this in the way he reproaches Crito for not knowing how to keep the principle established by their examination alive within himself, and for having rather thought and spoken in the mode of ordinary unexamined belief, which do harm to the soul. This brief episode, provoked by the question of funeral arrangements, is more significant than it appears at first glance. Indeed, the tireless care that Socrates provides his friend Crito, who in spite of his good intentions, obviously does not possess the necessary attention or capacity for reflection to take care of himself without the constant support of the vigilant therapist, Socrates, hints that there are several levels within the love of Sophia and within the care that humans can give to the affairs of the soul. Here, the oft-recurring comparison with the physician proves useful. No one would deny that one does not have to be a physician to hold medicine in high esteem and benefit from the physician's art by following his recommendations in matters of diet, of exercise, and lifestyle. It is not so different from the medicine of the soul that the philosopher practices at the individual level, as in the case of the Phaedo, or at the social level when he performs the task of a legislator or political advisor, establishing a regimen for collective life. Crito may not be a philosopher in the strong sense of the term, but through his attachment to a genuine lover of wisdom, Socrates, he benefits from the helpful thinking, phronesis, that his friend constantly practices. And Socrates, right until the very end, provides his friend with a particular care, as the Crito also shows, where Socrates works diligently to remind him of the principle of just conduct and to purify him of his erroneous opinions. This type of catharsis and of participation in thought and virtue by means of a persuasive guide is not to be confused, I think, with the blind civic virtues of bees and ants or the illusory virtue founded on the vices that Socrates denounces in the Phaedo. I don't think they are the same. That said, Socrates' therapeutic devotion is not strictly altruistic. If there is but one way to care for anything, and that is to provide for it the nourishment and emotions that are proper to it, as we learn in the Timaeus, then we may infer that Socrates also needs this community of care to provide his own soul with a source of constant exercise. His insistence upon the importance of repetition suggests this, a theme that is present in other dialogues as well. Phronesis, as the healthy thinking that ensures the healthful character of the virtues and of dialogue, is a process that must be constantly repeated in the sense of reactivated. It's not a one-time thing. This thought in motion, which heals, demands to be rethought and the arguments re-examined, a process that Socrates engages in at every opportunity in the company of others. So it's a collective enterprise. It would be wrong to consider this process in a strictly formal fashion, since Socrates, especially in the Phaedo, seems to be invested in repeating certain precise contents, which are presumed to be true after examination, and which are described as a form of nourishment. It's also a recurring metaphor in the corpus, as you know. Here, the food of the soul consists of, among other things, the theory of learning as recollection and the theory of forms, which we chew on again in the context of a critical examination that we perform collectively as readers with Socrates. Socrates presents this form of critical repetition of certain contents as a form of incantation that is good for the soul. And I think here we would disagree. It's not just myth or does not just target emotions. But the foods that help take care of the soul are not limited to philosophical theories redigested by means of examination. Socrates also feeds the soul of his companions with ancient traditions and mythical tales stemming from his own imagination, as in the case of the eschatological myth, where he offers a stunning description of the earth with distinct regions where the souls of the deceased go according to their past actions. The difference between the two types of nourishment may seem extreme, but insofar as the arguments for the immortality of the soul find their origin in ancient traditions and are always accompanied by doubt, the regime Socrates administers in the Phaedo is a regime that essentially consists of beliefs presumed to be true. That said, the dialogue provides for its reader at least one certainty in a paradoxical way, given the context of the Phaedo. This proof does not rest on reasoning, but on a fact of experience, Socrates himself. The most powerful testimony that the care for the soul he promotes does work is himself, his happiness, his virtue. The state of his soul in his dying moment, cheerful, confident, calm, his attitude throughout the discussion, benevolent, patient, curious, free, persistent, his bearing in the face of the condemnation, mindful of justice, courageous, pious, all contribute to creating the impression of not so much superhuman perfection, but specifically human accomplishment. Thanks to the living proof that Socrates gives us, it is no longer a matter of hope, but of certainty. Human beings can achieve this degree of health, of excellence, of happiness, if not for eternity, then at least in this life. Philosophy enables humans to attain this goal. From a protractic point of view, this aspect of the dialogue is crucial. The proofs for the immortality of the soul may well fail to convince most readers of the Phaedo, and to a certain extent, Socrates himself. He remains critical and prudent. But it is difficult to overestimate the impact of a portrait of Socrates as living proof of philosophy's therapeutic efficacy. A prime example is the altogether peculiar particular impression that Socrates in the Phaedo made upon a Stoic like Epictetus, in spite of his indifference to the theme of immortality. The possibility for humans to live here and now, a life free from fear and trouble, no matter what the circumstances, like Socrates did, will become the goal of philosophy itself as the medicine for the soul in diverse schools of philosophical practice, independent of the belief in immortality. The image of the soul as a pacified sea that philosophy progressively cleanses certainly has a proto-Stoic flavor to it. Attaining such a lasting psychological state is neither the soul nor even the primary goal that Socrates claims to pursue in the Phaedo. I remain fully aware of this. But by vividly painting this state of cheerful serenity as a beneficial result of the soul's detachment achieved through philosophy, Plato heightens the attraction and credibility of philosophy as a therapeutic practice socially, from a social point of view. As Socrates explains in the sample of protreptic wisdom offered in the Euthydemus, there is no better way to effectively convert someone to the care for virtue and love of wisdom than to show that they are the condition that enable one to attain what one already desires, namely happiness. The crucial protreptic element in the Phaedo, I think, is Socrates' happiness. This personified proof contributes a great deal to the dialogue's relevance to the contemporary reader, no less than to the ancient reader. For while the idea of a therapeutic purpose of philosophy is enjoying a renewal of interest nowadays, there are few philosophers today who hold as philosophers that the soul is immortal, and even fewer still on the basis of arguments that entail a theory of recollection and of intelligible forms. As Mark Johnston aptly puts it in his recent book, Surviving Death, the present state of research concerning the mind suggests that it was Simmias who was closer to the truth and not Socrates. The current dominant view of the mind is such that if the meaning and value of the exhortation to care for the psyche were completely dependent upon the belief in its immortality, then the non-historical interest, non-literary interest in the Phaedo would be radically diminished. Yet nothing in the text suggests that such an absolute dependence, which entails we do not do violence to the text if we consider them separately. I don't think we have to, but it's a possibility. regardless, Socrates and Plato's fight for philosophy's social recognition necessarily depends on the esteem for its privileged object of care, the soul, in the hierarchy of values. And now I turn to this sensitive issue. So from the apology up to the laws, there is a manifest struggle in Plato's dialogues to have a certain order of values adopted. And at the top of this order, we find the soul and its virtue. Philosophy depends upon the establishment of this hierarchy for its social recognition, and the philosopher depends on it for his survival. Now, in the context of this axiological fight for the priority of the care of the soul, we may ask whether the Phaedo goes to such extremes that it compromises or even negates its political significance. For if the hierarchical ideal is well suited to a political totality, an exclusive care for the soul does not seem to be a viable foundation for a properly functioning body politic. In a city, there must be a diversity of objects of care, which also demands a diversity of skills and individuals able to care for these things. Regarding the political ideal of hierarchy of objects of care, the Phaedo then seems to be highly problematic. In the part of the text that I will call the Second Apology, Socrates seems to promote a form of exclusion, even eradication of all other objects of care for the sake of a single one, the soul. The idea of a hierarchy of objects of care that Plato evokes so often elsewhere, subordinating the care for honors, the body, and material goods to the care for the soul, seems to have been rendered meaningless here, as only one remains, the soul. Worse still is that the body seems to have become an object of hostility. We must flee it, separate from it, and be irritated by the care it requires of us. In short, it seems Socrates does not promote a hierarchy here, but rather a strict axiological division that confers value exclusively on the soul at the expense of all other objects of care, especially the body. From a political standpoint, this contrast deserves attention and calls for closer inspection. Let us first note that while we might have the impression that this is an acutely divergent position, what that may be irreconcilable with the rest of the corpus, this could be due to a common exegetical error that consists in fusing what Socrates says about himself, which pertains specifically to the philosopher's situation, together with what he exhorts others to do. This confusion has many far-reaching consequences for the task of interpreting the dialogues in their unity. Let us take a closer look here. Already in the Apology, we can perceive the distinction between the orientation of the philosopher's care and that of other men, which is crucial in the Phaedo and the Republic. Take the following passage. After the judges found him guilty, Socrates attempts to defend himself one last time. What do I deserve to suffer or to pay because I have deliberately not led a quiet life, but have neglected what occupies most people, wealth, household affairs, the position of general or public orator, or the other offices, the political clubs and factions that exist in the city? Here we see that the objects Socrates claims not to care for are numerous, and his amelia towards them is certainly radical, just like in the Phaedo. However, to properly evaluate the scope of such a statement, we must bear in mind that Socrates is portraying himself as a atypical individual. Although he suspects some may attempt to imitate him, nothing suggests he would encourage all Athenians to follow him along such an extreme path. Socrates does indeed urge everyone to care first and foremost for something they usually neglect, something to which Socrates has dedicated his whole life, namely the care for the soul. This does not mean, however, that he is inviting every citizen to become a philosopher, to become a Socrates, and embrace a way of life similar to his own. What would a city made up of several thousand Socrates look like? In the Apology, Socrates does not reproach his fellow citizens for failing to embrace a lifestyle totally dedicated to the care of the soul, but rather for not caring at all for the soul or for what could improve it. And that in spite of the reputation for Sophia that distinguishes Athens. It's also an argument that Socrates used in his writings. To explain what is unique or incomprehensible about his own way of life, Socrates explains that a god prescribed to him the existence he leads, suggesting that it is an exception and does not apply to everyone. If my interpretation is correct, then Plato and his Socrates would not dream of converting every single person to philosophy, but rather desires a Socratization of the city by means of the care of the soul that consists of education, a well-ordered regime, and good laws under the guidance of a group of philosophers, legislators. If this political conversion is ever to be achieved, then the philosopher's full-time sort of care of the soul must become generally respected at a civic level, which was a challenge and still is a challenge. Everyone must, in this sense, care for the soul, honor it, assign it the highest value, and therefore respect those whose mission it is to take care of it. And showing respect may involve providing for their subsistence, which I think we're probably all very grateful for. Plato did that job for us. This is what Socrates means when, during his trial, he claims his real contribution to Athenians' happiness ought to be valued more highly than the esteem they presently accord to Olympic champions, those sculptors of the body. In modern terms, we could say that what is at stake is the problem of the role and social recognition of a certain group of intellectuals concerned for the public good. Let us return to the Phaedo. The two parallel passages on the melite thanatou are particularly important for the question regarding the disappearance of the ideal of the hierarchy of care and of values. Due to time constraints, I will concentrate on the first passage, which I call Socrates' second apology, since Socrates presents there a defense speech in a fictional trial. Insofar as we tend to understand Socrates and Plato's care for the soul in light of this disconcerting passage that declares philosophy is exercise of death, we ought to pay special attention to it. The second apology has three distinguishing marks that deserve our attention. First is the intended audience. While in the apology it is the relationship between Socrates and his fellow citizens that takes the center stage, as a therapist whose treatment has irritated his beneficiary, the present context is completely different. Socrates is not addressing himself to the public at large, but to a small group of loyal companions who are united by a shared orientation of interests. He speaks in the first person plural and imagines philosophers addressing other philosophers. Those he designates here as judges are converts, comrades who are also, to some degree, lovers of wisdom. That's the first thing. Second, everything that Socrates says in this defense speech concerning the body characterizes the lifestyle of a very particular category of people, again, the philosophers, philosophers' class. What Socrates says about his own way of life in the passage from the apology cited earlier, he now applies to all authentic philosophers, stressing their peculiarly amyletic relation to the body. Here, Socrates presents the body as an obstacle for the philosopher's own specific existential orientation in this life, namely the predominant care of the soul, which founds the religion of the philosopher that follows, namely the hope for future goods that await philosophers as soul completely purified of the body after death. The question concerning the historical Socrates does not interest me here, but let us note that in passing that this radically amyletic relation to the body and the Phaedo should not be chalked up to Plato becoming more ascetic than his master, since the caricature of Socrates that Aristophanes paints in the clouds already depicts an attitude of detachment and what I would call a corporeal style that are at once provocative, incomprehensible, and ridiculous in the eyes of the non-philosopher. This brings me to the final element, the style of discourse. The style is not exhortative, but rather factual, descriptive. In response, perhaps, to Aristophanes' caricature, Socrates and Plato attempt to explain and thereby legitimize the peculiar orientation of those who are absorbed by an intense love, a form of mania, like the cicadas in the Phaedrus, that takes the form of a dominant care which contributes to the devaluation of all other objects of concern. Here is how genuine philosopher lives, Socrates explained. Still, he does not invite each and every person to make his life into a training regimen for death. Here, Socrates presents the mental activity that separates the soul from the body as that which distinguishes the authentic philosopher. He's no longer defending his public mission of urging others to care for the soul. He's simply trying to explain his confident attitude towards death, which readily sets him apart as a philosopher from other people. In short, the second apology does not describe a way of life that Socrates wants everyone to adopt. Rather, he's describing the daily life of a philosopher, his own way of living. It is a different path, a misunderstood way of life, which looks like death in the eyes of others, and which requires, for this reason, an explanation. Hence, the main consequence of the plea that this philosopher addresses to other philosophers concerning the philosopher's existential orientation may be of allowing the non-philosopher a glimpse into this strange way of life. There is no need then to suppose that Socrates and Plato oscillated between an extreme asceticism in the Phaedo and a more moderate, politically aware approach to the care of the soul in other dialogues. A hermeneutical perspective that is sensitive to context and to the sociology of knowledge lets us see that we are not faced with a transformation, but rather a sort of complement. The difference between the philosopher's particular situation, being entirely enamored of the affairs of the soul, and the situation of non-philosophers who ignore and neglect this essential dimension of human life, suffices to explain this apparent contrast, which I think is a contrast that is just apparent. Furthermore, we must not over-exaggerate Socrates' pro-soul radicalism. If the exhortation to hierarchically rank the objects of care is not as evident in the Phaedo as in other dialogues, it is not totally absent either. We find at the end of the text a powerful, explicit reminder of the fact that Socrates remained faithful to this hierarchical ideal his whole life long. When Crito asked to dictate his will and adds, "What can we do that would please you most?" Socrates simply answers, and this is a passage that Professor Bossi quoted, so it's the passage where Socrates says, "Well, just care for yourself and everything will follow. Just focus on that." I won't read it again. This passage nicely illustrates the main reason why Socrates suggests everyone ought to care for the soul. It is itself the principle of care and proper use. Soul is this principle of care. If we take good care of it, first and foremost, it will ensure the welfare of everything else. Aside from the soul's epimeletic role, Socrates also invokes its hegemonic role, an apt way to help enhance its prestige in a culture that highly prizes leadership. Now, these two functions imply that the objects of concern are diverse and need to be ordered, for if the soul ought to be the primary object of care as a principle of governance and care for the rest, this entails that there are other objects of care that are also legitimate. Further, if we pay careful attention to the nuances of the language employed here, we can recognize that the Socrates of the Phaedo does not differ greatly from the Socrates of the Apology, who, far from being entirely disinterested in the care for the body, requires, demands to be fed at the state's expense in the prytaneum. The Socrates in the Phaedo, just as in the Apology, is no proto-cynic promoting extreme material deprivation as a means of moral development. If death appears to him in a favorable light, it is precisely because it liberates him from the burdensome service, therapia, owed to the body, a task that detracts from the concern for the soul insofar as it is a considerable source of ascolia. This reveals, by contrast, that the philosopher in the course of his embodied life, like all other humans, devotes a great deal of his time to taking care of his body and its needs. In short, by explaining why the philosopher rejoices at the idea of separating from his body, Socrates implicitly addresses the care that all humans owe to their bodies throughout their lives, including the philosopher. Nevertheless, the limits placed upon the philosopher's amelia towards everything that does not concern his soul and its phronesis does not erase the profound difference, a difference of intensity, between his almost exclusive preoccupation with the soul and his exhortation to hierarchically order concerns, which he addresses and applies to all citizens, as we see in the Apology and in the Laws. Further, the philosopher, the practitioner of death and detachment, as Socrates describes him, may seem like a radical, but he is in fact much more moderate than the many who do not trouble themselves over practically anything except for material things. What is more, this almost exclusive care for the body is the source of that social plague we call war, as Socrates explains in one of the Phaedo's few explicitly political passages. And I quote, "Only the body and its desires cause war, civil discord, and battles, for all wars are due to the desire to acquire wealth, and it is the body and the care for it to which we are enslaved, which compels us to acquire wealth," end of quote. In the same spirit of Socrates' fight against pleonixia in the Callipolis, the legislator and the laws has no other task than to correct this alienating concern, which is the origin of war, by taking any means possible to promote a hierarchy of values whose summit is the soul and its virtue. By way of conclusion, I would like to put forward a riskier, more adventurous reading in order to bring the Phaedo's political dimension and political relevance into sharper relief. Earlier, I claimed that the Second Apology and its description of philosophy as an exercise of death is not exhortative in nature. I would now like to qualify this claim, for in the two passages that evoke the melite thanatu, there is a repeated insistence on the fact that death will not trouble those who correctly philosophize. And this sounds like a challenge, a provocation even. It is a challenge issued to the fellow philosophers gathered around Socrates at this critical moment, but also issued to the ancient reader of the Phaedo, who is devoted to philosophy. The challenge spurs them to persist in their activities despite the hostility that they will encounter. Have also held that the Phaedo is a testimony to the efficacy of this new sort of care directed at the soul and attest to the competence of its practitioners, especially Socrates, who is in some sense the founder of a new order of Asklepiads. I now add that the dialogue also serves as a sort of warning against the political dangers that the pioneers of this art of care will have to face and as an exhortation to persist in the face of such threats. Although this reading is more speculative, it is not arbitrary, since the text itself evokes the danger of persecution to which philosophers expose themselves. First, the text hints at this danger in the attack that exclusively targets Anaxagoras and Socrates' autobiography. This critique could be an attempt on Plato's part to distinguish the Socratic tradition from the philosophical tradition represented by Anaxagoras, who also suffered persecution. Second, Plato explicitly refers to this danger right at the start of the dialogue when Simmias reacts to Socrates' explanation of the melite thanatu by declaring, ironically, that the crowd would agree that philosophers are begging for and deserving of death. What could be more benign today than the pursuit of wisdom? From a political standpoint, what could be more harmless and irrelevant than philosophy, sadly enough? Reading the Phaedo and keeping in mind the violent hostility towards Socrates, the political Asklepiad, demands a special effort of the contemporary reader's imagination. Even from an ancient perspective, we would have to ask ourselves why India, for instance, did not persecute its sages while Greece threatened or even killed many of its own. Seen in this light, the Phaedo is a resistance manifesto for philosophers, encouraging them to run the noble political risk that their love for wisdom and their practice of the care of the soul entails, namely the risk of an early death. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Annie Larivée.
Thank you.
We now have about 25 minutes for discussion. I see a raised hand. Please, the microphone. Okay. Kiki.
Thank you both for excellent papers. I just have a footnote for each of you and a comment. And it's actually the same footnote, almost. The dialogue begins by talking about the delay in the execution because of the ship, and Professor Bossi made one passing mention to it, but it's the ship of Theseus. it's a ship that commemorates Theseus's bringing salvation to the seven and seven. And it's well known that there are 14 named participants. So Socrates has the position of Theseus, and I think that that actually confirms or supports the interpretation of the final passage comparing Socrates to the physician who is providing a kind of salvation to the interlocutors, and that has the advantage of providing a nice literary chiasm from the beginning and the end. So that's the footnote for Professor Bossi, and the footnote for the second paper is that Theseus not only saved the seven and seven, but saved the state. So there's a political dimension that's hinted at right at the beginning. And that is consistent with the idea that the examination of the soul is something that's going to have some sort of political consequences. And that's some evidence. So that's a footnote. And the comment is that both of you talked about the care of the soul, and it's you talked about the comments about the care of the soul, and I couldn't hear this in the papers. Maybe it's what you intended, but to talk about whether the soul is immortal, and in the process talk about the nature of the soul, is to take care of the soul. So we have a kind of exhibition of the very process of caring for the soul that Socrates is encouraging his interlocutors to do, and that makes sense of the conclusion as providing a kind of a cure and salvation for his interlocutors, and therefore we owe the cock to Asklepios, the cock which also is a wake-up call, and it is a, since Theseus only provided one, he got the people out of one danger, no one would expect that he would provide lifelong salvation for everybody, just as Socrates provided his interlocutors with a way of avoiding the danger of despondency and anti-philosophical movement at his own death. And there's no guarantee that that's going to continue, as Professor Bossi pointed out.
Well, thank you for the footnote, and I don't think I have understood the objection. I have understood the part when you agree, but could you reformulate the objection, please?
Yeah, I'm not sure it is an objection. Really, but what I wanted to get at was that the therapy you suggested at one point that the therapy was emotional, and Professor Larivée took exception to
not,
that.
Not just emotional. No, right. No. Okay. I'm sorry, she understood that. I'm sorry, everybody has perhaps misunderstood me. I did not wanted to say that the therapy was just emotional. Not at all. I think both methods are complementary, logos and pathos, and so.
That's all.
Thank you.
Dr. Bossi. I agree with you that it's very hard to understand the last words, and I found it a very interesting discussion, but I guess my worry is that it seemed like on your view in the end, it's just the very fact that we're oriented in the correct way that means that we've been healed. And I wonder if Plato would really think of that as a form of healing, as if just receiving the drugs is enough to now give a cock to Asklepios. No, you have to actually take the drugs and become healed before you would give a cock to Asklepios. So are we, on your reading, should we really be giving a cock to Asklepios yet? If all that's happened to Socrates' companions is that they're pointed in the right direction, but they're not at all they're not there yet, and not only are they not there yet, they're very far from there. Should we be offering a cock to Asklepios yet? So that has me worried that that's really the thing. Do you see the concern?
I see, yeah. Well, I cannot give an answer in the sense that in which sense everyone who is there is on the right track or is not or is whatever. So it's impossible to give an answer. But I understand that you may say, why should he offer a cock to Asklepios if he thinks they are just being put on the right track? But, well, I have emphasized this, his own job. I think he can say, I've done my job, and now it's time for you to do the rest. And anyway, we have had this chance of meeting each other and talking and experiencing care and this and that. And as she also said, it is Socrates that needs this community. So, and this is very clear in the Phaedrus, I think. So the need for care and is mutual. And of course, Socrates is the guide, the master, the mentor, and he has done the big job. But I think he wants to compromise them all in the same. That's what I suggested. But of course, I cannot give you a full answer. But just say, I think using this plural, he wanted to say, hey, come on, all of us have something to be grateful for. Thank you.
If I can follow up on this briefly, I think here again, the metaphor of health is very useful. Health, we can make a positive contribution to it by adopting a correct diet or, you know, performing exercise or taking drugs, but it's never a task that we're over with. You know, we always have to continue taking care of health. It's not something that you can just, you know, settle. I'm healthy, that's it, so I can stop. So yes, it's not just a protractic, but on the other hand, I would agree with Professor Bossi that it's an never-ending task.
Yes, thank you. Panayotis Thanasas is my name. I have kind of question, proposal, remark, mainly to Professor Bossi, but to some extent also to Professor Larivée. You criticized Crookes. Now, Crookes says we owe a cock to Asklepios because there is a healing, it's the healing from mythology. Now, I think Crookes is basically right, but for a reason he himself failed to make clear. And I would like to add, in order to support him, an observation we can make it in text, in the very text itself. Now, there is a cure mentioned in the text, in 89A. Professor Larivée mentioned it, but not in the in this context, where Phaedo says to Hecrates, he cured us. Now, this gives us a very clear scheme, actually, which is we owe the cock to Asklepios because for a cure that has taken place, and Socrates was the doctor who healed the others from mythology. It's surprising to me that, as far as I know, nobody has made this observation, nobody has tried to connect the proposal of Crookes with this incident that we have this Iasato in 89A, and I would like to hear your comments, possibly, to this proposal. Thank you.
Well, I think I agree with Crook in many ways, but I find this triumph problematic because, as we said before, it's something you can never be completely safe in a, absolutely safe. So you have to strive for it. I would say. So it's something that it never ends. So in a sense, I agree that it's a clue, but it's not the most important clue of the dialogue, that passage of mythology, I mean, because it is he insists on the fact that nobody is out of temptation, nobody is safe, nobody can proclaim to be absolutely safe and sound on this. I think, yes, he is the doctor. Yes, he teaches them to love Logos and not to blame Logos of their own faults. And yes, that's true. He's the teacher, he's the doctor. But nobody can be sure. Nobody can be safe. Nobody can be have a vaccine and it's over. So, and that is common. It comes in the Sophists, it comes in many passages. Where Plato says, anyone can fall in the trap of getting angry at, or of pursuing victory, of you know. So it is something to be done. That's why I think this crook has a good argument, but I'm not totally convinced because of that.
We have to take into account that it's Phaedo who says that they've been healed, and you focus on a passage where Socrates says that the healing process is still
going on. Yeah.
But they were in a critical situation, so I think they can be especially proud that even in such extremely powerful situation, they were able to remain faithful to philosophy as a form of care. And that's why there is this emphasis on the fact that, yes, there is something that's been achieved. They stuck to the method, they stuck to the remedy, and they're proud of it.
Thank you very much for both the speakers. I really
Yes, I see you now. For the philosophers as such, it is cognitive. I would agree with you. But I think that there's another social aspect as emphasized in the laws in particular, where the therapy doesn't take necessarily a cognitive form, although it is linked to cognition, because the philosophers as a group have this understanding. So there is a kind of, for the rest of the body politics, there is a link to wisdom, but it's not a direct link. They are turned to philosophy in the sense that they are turned towards the philosopher as the proper people who are responsible for that type of task. So they respect wisdom in the sense that they respect the social role that philosophers can play. In the laws, it's a bit more complex than in the Republican or the statesman. But I think that in the Nuctarinos Sulogos, philosophers are still there, but they're hidden. You know, this cognitive function is hidden, because I think that's the struggle, that's the challenge that Plato was faced with. There's this new class of intellectuals who need to survive and to prove their usefulness and their role in a social setting, and it's difficult to explain it to people who will not follow you on the terrain of knowledge and argumentation. So you have to prove your usefulness differently, and I think that's why Plato thought it was important to emphasize Socrates' therapeutic mission, because if you play a therapeutic mission, you prove your utility socially. So that's what I wanted to stress with my paper. The Phaedo makes a contribution. It provides evidence that this form of therapy works, that there is an expertise, that and it also it can show what happens when you put the soul first. But it does not invite everybody, I think, to become a philosopher and to share in that cognitive activity. So this is where we have to be prudent, I think. We confuse this. When we think of the exhortation to care for the soul, we tend to think that Socrates invited everybody to participate in philosophy directly, which I think is not a correct interpretation. Yes, of course. Well, I'm not the chair, but... I see. Okay, so philosophy, okay, so it would be performed collectively. Yes, there was this aspect also in my care. Thank you very much for emphasizing this. Yes.
Thank you very much for your very persuasive presentations. But I feel like I must have maybe a kind of similar on the CVs. And one thing disturbs me, and I'd like to ask you a question. Whether you regard Socrates' last words the words of historical Socrates or not, because if healing is made through the argument the last day, and the arguments are mainly concerned Plato's own, that means so.
I'm sorry, it cuts, so I can't hear properly.
Okay, and so my question is simple. I'd like to ask whether you regard the last words as the historical Socrates words, because the argument which are supposed to have healed his friends and others mainly consists of Plato's own arguments. And then if Plato's own arguments cannot heal, that's the main question anyway. So your argument seems to based on the presupposition that it's so it conflicts with the supposition that those words are Socrates' own.
Mm-hmm. I don't think this. Do you object to the? Are you suggesting the idea that arguments do not cure?
I want to say that gratitude,
yes,
cannot be the gratitude for the arguments. For example, the arguments for the soul's immortality, because they are arguments by Plato, not by Socrates.
Ah. Well, I would not separate these two aspects of the dialogue. I would not separate pathos and logos. I would not separate them because they are embraced in the dialogue. So I would say that gratefulness is for just the arguments or not for the arguments or for the pathos or for... No, I would say that the gratefulness is for the experience they have had together. And of course this is Plato's work. I am with Charles Kahn. I don't think we can separate Socrates from Plato and say these were the real words or not. I'm talking about the dialogue. I'm not talking about Socrates or I don't know. I cannot answer that question. I can only say what happens here, not, I'm sorry, but.
Thank you.
So two more questions, but please be brief. Okay, you? Yes.
My name is Mariana. I have two related to each other questions to both Professor Beatriz Bossi and Annie.
Larivée.
Oui. S'il vous plaît, merci. They are rather rhetorical questions. To be on the safe side, we can take for sure that Socrates cured his interlocutors from the fear of death, as Phaedo says to Echecrates, and Echecrates too probably got cured, since later he exclaims that it is so clear for every man, even of a small intelligence. And we can say that Socrates cured people about the mythology. But we haven't but to look at this problem through the lenses of Phaedo, since we don't know why did Socrates want to consecrate the cock to Asklepios. For example, maybe because Asklepios stole the people, both souls and body, from the domain of Hades. I don't insist on this explanation. I say the first thing which came to my mind. The question is, I like to challenge the things usually taken for granted. Usually it is taken for granted that philosophy is medicine. This is the Platonic idea. Indeed, if we look at the Platonic tradition, for example, Boethius' Consolation of Philosophy, philosophy works like medicine. But if we take different dialogues, it is not always so. In Gorgias, for example, law or politics are like medicine, and philosophy is something above. In laws, also, lawyers work like physicians, and in the law sense, like surgeons, they cut off every sick part of the body. So my question is, how much can we use other Platonic dialogues? Of course, we cannot do without this, but how much is it correct? How many of different periods, dialogues of different periods, can we use to explain the ideas of this or that dialogue? This is purely rhetorical question. I can pass the microphone to my colleague.
Shall I ask? I could ask you that in the break if you think there's no time remaining. Okay, then very quick. To Beatrice, I was wondering, in your extensive study of the literature, have you found anyone trying to connect the mention of Asklepios to the medical description of the 10 previous lines? We have a very nice description of the progression of the poison through the feet, the legs, the belly of Socrates. Is it a good idea to you that we should connect, maybe? And to Annie Larivée, I wanted to ask if, I like your suggestion that the political angle of the Phaedo is maybe the idea of a philosophical resistance and preparation to death. Would you accept the suggestion that it's happened already in the Apology, after mentioning the risk of death for the philosopher if he opposes the opinion of the crowd? At 28c, then Socrates accepts it, referring to Achilles. Achilles knew he would die if he would kill Hector, and he decided to do it nevertheless, and Socrates is, well, Achilles is our model.
Well, thank you very much, Arnaud. You just reinforced my interpretation, but yes, I totally agree that these passages could be interpreted in the same light. Yeah, I think it's probably a neglected theme in the interpretation of these dialogues, but the Stoics will pay close attention to this topic. And we can see it develop, that the philosophers are submitted to some kind of persecution. There is a very strong hostility between philosophers and non-philosophers, and I think that, yes, there are many aspects of the corpus that become clearer when we read them in this political problem, in the light of this political problem. And the apology, yes, I would agree that these passages are extremely relevant for my interpretation anyways.
So I didn't catch the meaning of the question very well. So you're saying that the progression of the poison would have something to do with the final words? What is the question?
We might have a very medical description of how Socrates is dying.
Yes.
So I haven't made the analysis myself. I don't know if anyone has attempted to compare this to any page of the corpus, the Hippocratic corpus. Do we have a serious medical description of somebody dying from hemlock? And if so, I don't know, but the interpretation I would risk would be a bit depressing, is that we're back to the bones and nerves mentioned in 98. Socrates said, you shouldn't explain anything by my bones and nerves, why I'm sitting here in this prison.
Right.
We're losing him. We're down to the bodily medical description of how he's dying.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe he's just reminded of what it is to be the patient of a doctor at this point.
Mm-hmm.
And he's reminding that for whatever reason he forgot to pay a cock and he's turning to Crito, who pays for all his invoices, and
mm-hmm.
say, we forgot that. But that would go towards Gautier. It's a bit depressing that it's...
That you're going back to Gautier. Ah, les friends, la France. We can go on.